When you were starting out as a writer, you were a black, impoverished homosexual. You must have said to yourself, gee, how disadvantaged can I get?
Oh, no, I thought I hit the jackpot.
Oh, great.
It was so outrageous you could not go any further, you know. It had to be, so you had to find a way to use it.
Renaissance was going on. I was a part of that. And while I hadn't published things like Langston, Conte, and even Wally, I had written one poem that Langston had retrieved from a wastebasket. It was a poem called Shadow. It created kind of a sensation at the time. It was considered to be a race poem, although I hadn't meant it to be. I intended to be a soul-searching poem of another kind of lonesomeness. You see, I'm a homosexual. And it never occurred to me that it was anybody's business but mine. You know what that good old Negro song, ain't nobody's business but I do.
Harlem was something new under the sun. Barely a decade old at the beginning of its artistic renaissance, New York City's black population had swelled and moved to the current of the Great Migration.
Time is getting hard, boy is getting scared. Soon as I gather my cotton and corn, I'm bound to leave this place.
The wash and rush of this human tide on the beach line of the northern city centers is to be explained primarily in terms of a new vision of opportunity, of social and economic freedom, of a spirit to seize, even in the face of an extortionate and heavy toll, a chance for the improvement of conditions.
Alan Locke was a philosopher. He was born in the 1880s, and he taught at Howard University. He was the first black person to get a PhD in philosophy from Harvard University. And he came up with this concept of the New Negro. It was already around, but he interpreted it as that of being the quintessential American artist who mined the black experience, folklore, the spirituals, and turned that into high art. So he was really a person who brought the interpretive context for black artists to be appreciated, really for the first time.
Fussy and imperious, Dr. Locke was fanatical about the promotion of high culture, yet was able to suss out the writers who showed the most promise and originality. His editorship of the 1926 survey graphic, later published in book form as The New Negro, marked the triumphal entrance of the Harlem Renaissance on the literary scene.
And he changed the conversation about what it meant to be black in the United States from one of being a ward or problem to actually an asset.
Locke was gay, favoring male students and initiating those whom he found to be like-minded to the writings of Walt Whitman and Edward Carpenter.
Locke is a complicated figure in the history of the black gay movement because he's closeted and behaved in ways that were seemingly patriarchal. At the same time, he was probably generally known to be gay.
As unofficial press agent and mentor to the new generation, Locke combined a highly trained understanding of classical culture with strong views about where the Negro could make his contribution. Culture begins, he wrote, where compulsion leaves off. The New Negro's most promising poet, County Cullen, shared the sentiment, but he couldn't live it. By 1925, at the age of 22, Cullen had won every prize available, poetry contests, a Phi Beta Kappa key from New York University, and the publication of the most highly praised book by a poet of color in American letters. But his best-known poems reflected his race and, in veiled fashion, his sexuality.
The relationship between Cullen's sexual orientation and his poetry is extremely complex. I see it as about Cullen's longing and secrecy, two great themes in all of Cullen's poetry and in all of his life.
It opened up for me. Soul windows which had been closed. It threw a noble and evident light on what I had begun to believe because of what the world believes, ignoble and unnatural. I loved myself in it.
My man got a heart like a rock cast in the sea.
Under the sadness of the blues, there's always this determination, this marching on, this basic beat that keeps you living.
I'll make you miserable, treat us women like you do. I'll make you miserable, treat us women like you do.
And when we moved, we were more than graceful. Already our music and dancing had entered the culture at large. The new record industry liberated this music from tent shows and vaudeville stages. And with the money that we spent to hear crazy blues and downhearted blues, we created the first class of black divas in history. These blues queens of the 1920s comprised the first sizable group of working-class Americans to sing their way to fame and fortune. They were independent women, free of domestic shackles, large in lifestyle and lavish in costume.
They were an alternative culture, even among their own culture, where the predominant music and expression was in the church.
Two of the biggest names in the blues world were Bessie Smith and Ma Rainey. Having grown up in severe poverty, Bessie was violent, foul-mouthed, a heavy drinker, and sexually promiscuous. Her 1923 marriage to Jack G, a union rife with abuse and infidelity, put no damper on her occasional interest in others.
Bessie Smith started having relationships with women. It was very much a taboo in the society at large, and more of a taboo in the African-American community. But she found a way to be all of the people she was, to live out all those parts and aspects of her personality.
What you looking around for? Who gonna see you? And so what if they do? Hey. They got to prove it on you, baby.
In 1928, Ma Rainey wrote and recorded a glorious, if ultimately ambiguous, anthem to women-loving women. The ad for the song in the Chicago Defender did nothing to allay their readers' artfully aroused suspicions.
Went out last night with a crowd of my friends. There must be women, cause I don't like no men. It's too a wild color and a tie. Makes the wind blow all the while. But to say I do it, ain't nobody caught me. They sure got to prove it on me.
Although a so-called Negro Renaissance was taking place in arts and letters, little of this filtered into the world of the black proletariat. Likewise, the middle-class writers who produced the novels and poems getting published by civil rights journals and white publishing houses paid scant attention to the lives and preoccupations of the working class. The great exception to this could be found in the works of Claude McKay, the Jamaican poet who broke ground for black writing with the publication of Harlem Shadows in 1922. His 1928 novel, Home to Harlem, the first African-American book to become a bestseller, presented, some said titillated, its readers with cabarets and speakeasies, prostitutes and kept men, bootleg gin, and cocaine. Like other writers of his sexual orientation, McKay never publicly acknowledged his homosexuality. In Home to Harlem, McKay describes the Congo, a fictional cabaret that hosts not only the familiar pansy, but the much less well-known character of the masculine gay.
There's a baby doll over at the horse tent.
Oh, that's my new dancing partner.
Another entertainer? Congo's going along fast enough, huh?
You bet. Pretty soon the old face be nosing or not, then we have to take a back seat.
Who's the wolf?
Billy. He's the owner of the club.
Why they call him the wolf?
Because he eats his own kind.
What that mean?
With the end of the war came the reaction. The entire country was caught in a boom of prosperity, spending, and license. In New York, the post-war reaction reached exaggerated and glamorous heights. Money was easily acquired and freely spent. Saloons closed in fanfares of maudlin guzzling, only to be reborn as speakeasies. Greenwich Village blossomed into a mad bohemia that outdid any of those on the continent. Harlem flowered into a unique amusement center, and Broadway extended itself into the many side streets.
Dubbed Niggerati Manor by Zora Neale Hurston, 267 West 136th Street became the headquarters of Harlem's bohemian and modernist wings. Leader of the manor was Wallace Thurman, a slight, dark-skinned man of fierce judgment and inexhaustible activity. Thurman attracted a constellation that included Hughes, Hurston, the artist Aaron Douglas, Bruce Nugent, and Thurman's Scandinavian lover, Bunny Stephenson. In 1926, Thurman put out an arts journal named after the spiritual written by Hall Johnson and Langston Hughes.
We need to show things that other magazines won't. If not, then why bother?
We're ready to get low down and nasty.
There you go. Always want to go mucking around in the gutter.
And wait a minute, he has a point. Bruce and I were thinking that there are two types of people that upstanding Negroes want no part of.
Queers and whores, the types that we're the most fond of.
Nugent, whose drawings were also featured in the journal, published the first overtly gay romance in American literature. Written in impressionistic prose, Smoke, Lilies, and Jade focused on the bohemian life of Alex, a thinly disguised Nugent, as he floats through the Harlem Renaissance and finds his feelings roused for a new friend, Adrian, whom he calls Beauty.
Alex ran his hand through Beauty's hair. Beauty's lips pressed hard against his teeth. Alex trembled, could feel Beauty's body close against his. Hot, tense, white, and soft, soft, soft.
We blacks have always been in the vanguard of gay and lesbian visibility. James Baldwin, Audre Lorde, Marlon Riggs, and a host of others. Black gays and lesbians were forced to forge their identities without knowledge of their history. But that is changing. The buried legacy is coming to light. As we dig up our past, as lesbians and gays reclaim their history, our two minority communities will discover some common ancestors and will, if not join hands, perhaps recognize each other's humanity. Then, it will be America's turn.
Our journey is not complete until our gay brothers and sisters are treated like anyone else under the law. For if we are truly created equal, then surely the love we commit to one another must be equal as well.